This is Tumbleweed Radio. I'm Connor Orr. When was the last time you thought about the history of labor in the United States? It's not a thing that comes up very often in day-to-day conversation, unless you have a specific interest in the subject, and labor history is rarely covered at all in public education, certainly not to any great degree. But the history of mankind in general, and of the United States in particular, is largely a history of exploitation, in which the upper class has accumulated and maintained power through the blood, sweat, and toil of disenfranchised people. There is a lot of talk these days about the new rise of communism in America. I'm not going to wade into those waters, and I'm not going to make any sort of argument for or against a more socialized society, but there are certain facts that need to be recognized in this country so that we can understand who we are and how we got here. If we aren't willing to face and account for the ugliest aspects of our past, we are certain to play them out again. Conflict between the upper and lower classes is one of mankind's longest-standing traditions, dating back at least as far as the beginning of written history. Aristotle once wrote that poverty is the parent of revolution, and this sentiment has been tested and verified time after time. The United States were built on labor exploitation, first through the devastating and prolonged use of slavery, and later through diabolical methods of early industrial labor, which primarily involved profiteering off of backbreaking work of the lower classes, mostly immigrants, who were often paid literal pennies per day for performing some of the most difficult and dangerous work ever invented. One of the wildest discoveries that I have made as a young adult is that my own hometown, Walsenburg, Colorado, and southern Colorado in general, were once the scene of a particularly brutal bit of class warfare. One that shocked the nation and helped lead to the kinds of labor protection laws and safety standards that we have come to take for granted today. Just over 100 years ago, there were people engaged in the fights for their lives, right here in the streets of Walsenburg and in Trinidad, and in the tiny communities spread all across the prairies and mountains that surround this area. Back then, there was no guarantee that a person could only work an 8-hour day, and children were often encouraged and coerced into hard and dangerous labor. There are many instances in which companies controlled every aspect of their workers' lives, from hours and wages to education and leisure. It's common knowledge around these parts that our region was practically built by the coal mining industry, but for many folks, especially of my generation, that is pretty much where our understanding stops. Sure, we have mining days every year. Artwork of miners, mules, and canaries can be found all over the place, and there are relics, ancient foundations, and old bits of rusted metal machinery littered across the landscape. But much of this is accepted as nothing more than an aesthetic quality of our region. We've become very disconnected from the harsh reality of what mining was like in the 20th century, and from the brutal warfare that defined the struggle to make that reality more bearable. And I do mean warfare. Strikes were often violently suppressed in the 20th century, and there is a fascinating and disturbing history of striking and strike-breaking in this country that really does read like descriptions of actual war. The conflicts in Colorado are only one small piece of the puzzle, and are intimately tied to other instances of violent striking, particularly in West Virginia, but because they happen in our own backyard, we're going to focus on them today and over the next few episodes. Now, frankly, this is a humongous topic to talk about, and it is one of the deepest rabbit holes that I have ever stumbled upon. There is no way that I will be able to cover all or even most of the important people and events that shaped this period. For the sake of making some headway, I'm going to focus specifically on the strike of 1913 through 14 and the resulting violence that has come to be known as the Colorado Coalfield War. I recently had the opportunity to speak with and record a conversation with Zeese Papanikolas, who is the author of one of the definitive works on the Colorado Coalfield War, and in particular, on the experience of Greek immigrant miners and strikers during this period. His book is called Buried Unsung, Louis Tikas and the Ludlow Massacre, and it is a riveting read. Over the next few weeks, I'll include snippets from our conversation to flesh out my description of these events, and I will draw from and quote Buried Unsung on numerous occasions. Today, though, I'd like to start off by painting a picture. I want to help you to understand the events that unfolded during the Colorado Coalfield War by placing them into a bit of context. The early 20th century was a time of incredible change in the world. The Industrial Revolution had fully made its mark on Western society, but mechanization was not so advanced that huge scores of humans weren't necessary to keep things moving. The days of the American Wild West had come and gone, by and large, but there were still people who lived by gun law, as it was known, and repercussions for companies protecting their private interests at the expense of workers' lives were minimal, at best. There's a great passage on page 109 of Buried Unsung that describes the way that the prevailing ideologies at the time of industrialism and imperialism blended in the early 20th century into a psychology of othering that enabled mine operators and society at large to look down their noses at the largely immigrant populations who manned the factories and mines. Quote, "Imperialism is as much an attitude as it is a struggle for bits of ground in far-off lands. In Hay's audience, the businessmen and militarists and politicians who supported him, the psychologies of imperialism and industrialism merged. Both the insecurities and appetites for conquest of that audience translated themselves, unhappily, into the language of the industrial world. For these men, when they weren't presenting themselves as enlightened social scientists, had come to consider the nation's mines and mills and factories as nothing more than internal colonies, and the shabby foreigners who manned them as volatile and discontented natives, no more able to govern themselves than the Puerto Ricans or the Tagalogs of Luzon." I mean, that's pretty dark, right? But it really explains how these mine operators were able to justify the patronizing, downright cruel treatment of their workers, and it helps explain how the public in general was able to stand by and let things like this happen. Like in so many other instances of institutional cruelty, the trick to getting one group of people to support the subjugation of another was to systematically paint the other group as subhuman. Imagine with me, if you will, a tiny and shabbily constructed town in a canyon, immediately outside a coal mine. The town is fenced in with barbed wire, and there are dirt roads connecting a handful of houses to a company store, a saloon, which doubled as a church on Sundays, and a small one-room schoolhouse. In the early 20th century, these types of town came by the dozen, and these were the worlds of miners and their families. Mining companies understood that every mine was temporary, so they did not see it as financially prudent to invest much money in the construction of decent facilities for their workers. Mining companies also viewed themselves as the patriarchs of their workers, since they were supplying employment and all the basic necessities of life to their workers, they felt entitled to a high degree of respect and cooperation. Never mind the fact that the workers had to pay rent and live in the company housing if they wanted to keep a job, or that even going into town to buy accommodations at more affordable prices could result in a worker losing their job. Coal town accommodations were of the lowest quality, and the necessities provided for workers and their families hardly afforded the quality of life that was available to people outside of the company towns. Miners in those days were treated as independent contractors, which allowed the companies to charge them steeply for their equipment, for their housing, and to only pay them for the actual tons of coal that were brought out from the ground, instead of the equally important dead work that had to be performed in order to do so, like blasting, drilling, digging, and constructing support for the walls and ceilings of the long, snaking tunnels. Miners were often injured or killed in the mines, but since they were classified as independent contractors, the company was able to provide compensation to their families at their own discretion. Accidents underground were often extremely brutal, and the risk of explosions was so high that miners would carry numbered brass coins with them so that their body could be identified in the event of a disfiguring death. At the time, coal miners would spend most of their days almost entirely underground, taking an elevator in the morning thousands of feet down into pitch blackness and not emerging until the sun had long since set. In the mines, they might be divided into shifts filled with folks from numerous different countries, so that it would be extremely difficult to communicate with your coworkers. Mine owners and operators feared the organization of unions above all else, and went to great lengths to discourage any kind of fraternization between workers. After all, when working a horrible job thousands of feet underground, what are you going to talk about with your coworkers, other than how horrible your circumstances are? Here's a snippet of my conversation with Zeese Papanikolas about the experience of being a coal miner back then.
Well, what you have to remember is that coal mining in those days was not highly mechanized. And so coal miners were taken by an elevator to their various levels of the mine, and they were given a room. And they would drill into the face of the coal seam with hand drills, and then they would place powder charges and tamp them down with clay or with whatever else they could find, and then they'd light the fuse and get the hell out of there. The coal would crumble and fall to the ground, and then the job was to load it by hand into a coal car, and pretty soon a mule would come clomping out of the darkness. It would be hitched to the coal car and taken up to the surface of the mine. Well, this was dangerous work because, of course, the ceiling of the mine, if you weren't careful and didn't test it, could come crashing down on you, or gases in the mine could be released that could be blown up by a spark or any kind of flame in your lamp or the lamp you had on your hat. So it was extremely dangerous work.
And how long? Excuse me. Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was just curious about how long these folks would be underground. Was it the sort of thing where they would accompany the cart back up with the mule, or were these miners basically beneath the ground for the entire day?
Yeah, they were beneath the ground for the entire day. Now, at the time of the coal strike in southern Colorado in 1913-14, there were laws on the books of Colorado that said that you had an eight-hour day, but they were not enforced, and that was one of the demands that the strikers made. Now, once the car got up to the tipple, it would be weighed, and there was a check on each car that was the number of the miner who had filled the car, and there was a check weighman. And the weighman would record how much that load of coal weighed, and you would be paid for it, and you would be paid by the ton. So these workers were, according to the coal companies, independent contractors. And the more coal they loaded, the more they got paid.
Well, and that's a great... go ahead.
Yeah, well, there's a big problem with that because the miners, they thought that they were being cheated at the scales, and there's some evidence that they were. And so among the demands that they had when they went on strike was that they would select their own check weighman. In other words, it wasn't the company that was going to hire some guy to, you know, mark down how much coal they dug. It would be presumably a neutral check weighman, so they couldn't be cheated. And they wanted an advance in the wage they were paid per ton. As far as the danger that goes, that is associated with mining, because they were independent contractors, presumably they were just responsible for their own safety. And so if you were injured in a mine, lost an arm, a leg, couldn't work, if you died, it was up to the company's discretion what they would pay your widow or what they would pay your family if you were dead. And in that way, the company avoided paying these damages and avoided lawsuits. So this was another thing that unionism would help the miners achieve, being able to negotiate for damages and for health care.
Well, I think that deeming the miners independent contractors was really, really beneficial for the companies in numerous ways. I mean, is it the case that they would have to pay for all of their equipment, typically purchasing them at these company stores for really blown up, skyrocketed prices, and they would have to pay for their own dynamite and the such?
I'm not sure that they had to pay for their own. Dynamite wasn't used so often for the kind of mining that the coal miners were doing. I mean, it would be used to open up a mine or something like that, but it was black powder. And, you know, I think that they were responsible for that, and that would be charged against them. And the company store is, again, another demand that the miners had, because they were really forced to trade at the company store. And as you said, the prices were much higher than they could get if they just went to town. And this is something that enraged them. And if they were caught dealing in town for a pair of overalls, then they could be fired. And they wanted abolition of the company store system. And they wanted abolition of scrip, which was another way that they were taken advantage of. Because scrip, which is, you know, funny money, is not negotiable except in the company store. You could go into town and you could give a chit for $5 worth of goods in a saloon, say, but they'd discount it. You wouldn't get $5 back for it. I don't know what you'd get. You might get four, might get $3.50, but at any rate, scrip kept you locked into the company store system. And I think, Connor, if you want a little music, you might want to remember that old song, 16 Ton.
What do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right. And it was true, I think, you know, well into the 20th century, you know, that you were kind of tied to the company store.
Well, and that's fascinating, and it really is kind of a brutal irony that a lot of these folks were going into these mines specifically to support their families, maybe back home. And I mean, is there any way to exchange chit for money, or were they pretty much locked into the system where once they got to the mines, they had to survive off of what they could get, and there was really no way to send money home?
Yeah. Well. Well, as I said, you could use it. It could be discounted if you took it to a saloon or a bank. So you weren't getting full value for your $5 or your $10. And I don't know whether they were paid entirely in scrip or partially in scrip, but it was definitely a part of the wage system in Colorado and also, you know, in West Virginia and places like that.
And it's interesting, you know, you mentioned West Virginia, and that's, it seems like the relationship between the West Virginia mines and the Colorado mines was very, very strong. You know, I know that there's an entire history of the labor organizing and really of warfare that went on in Virginia as well. And I don't know that we're going to be able to touch that too much in this podcast, but I do think it's worth mentioning that a lot of the terror that really set... was set rampant in Ludlow and in Forbes was because they had seen the way that mine operators had employed folks like the Baldwin Phelps detectives and other goons, really, to suppress striking with violence. Is that fair to say?
Yes. Yeah. Well, there had been a big strike in Paint Creek in West Virginia just before Ludlow, and the tents. That many of the tents that were used at Ludlow came from West Virginia. We should say why the strikers were in tents. They were in tents because they had been living in company housing, you know, which they also had to pay for, in the canyons where the coal mines were located. Now, they knew that the minute they went on strike, they would be evicted from those houses, and the union, of course, knew it. And so the union set up tent colonies in the in the prairies at the entrances to the canyons. And the largest of these was Ludlow. There are probably 1,000 people living in tents in Ludlow. And the reason they put them in these prairies surrounding the mines is to keep track of the scabs that would be getting off of trains and going up to the mines. And they would picket the trains and try and keep the scabs from going up to the mines. And sometimes it was brutal, sometimes they convinced the scabs to turn back. I heard a story, it didn't get into my book, of somebody who had known about Louis Tikas, said at one point he jumped on a train that was heading toward the Ludlow station. There were a bunch of Greeks on the train, scabs. He said to him, "You know, what are you doing here? You know, you're taking bread out of the mouth of your fellow countrymen. You know, you should be ashamed of yourselves. And furthermore, if you don't get off the train, I'm going to kill you." So they, you know, he had his methods, but in general, that's what they were doing in these tent colonies.
This has been a brief introduction to what life was like as a miner in the southern coal fields in the early 20th century, but I hope it served to educate or entertain you. Next week, I'm going to dig into the history of the United Mine Workers of America, Mother Jones, and I will begin to talk about the infamous strike of 1913 through 14. This podcast was produced by me, Connor Orr, with sound design and research by me, Connor Orr. Special thanks to Zeese Papanikolas for coming on the show, and as always, thanks to the World Journal for providing a platform. I now leave you to the sweet sounds of 16 Tons, written by Merle Travis and performed by Tennessee Ernie Ford.
Some people say a man is made out of mud. A poor man's made out of muscle and blood. Muscle and blood and skin and bones. A mind that's weak and a back that's strong. You load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. I was born one morning when the sun didn't shine. I picked up my shovel and I walked to the mine. I loaded 16 tons of number 9 coal, and the star boss said, "Well, bless my soul, you load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store. I was born one morning, it was drizzling rain. Fighting and trouble are my middle name. I was raised in the canebrake by an old mama lion. Can't know a high-toned woman make me walk the line. You load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store." If you see me coming, better step aside. A lot of men didn't, a lot of men died. One fist of iron, the other of steel. If the right one don't get you, then the left one will. You load 16 tons, what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store.